and making sure that we have higher education as a viable option.
Thank you very much, Paul. Chief Atleo, would you like to add to that?
Just great comments. You know, I like the notion that, you know, I'm one that gets really badly homesick. And so whenever I hear that kind of a notion, it's tough to leave home, like, I get that, because that's all I ever want to be is home. And like I said, Paul's seen my home. So, you know, like a lot of the places where we come from, that's where family is, right? And but by the same token, that other comment that, you know what, family very proud when you take the step to go and pursue your learning, because it's an opportunity for growth. Growth is never easy. And I think about, you know, whether it's the Mi'kmaq Nation or the Nunchaknal Nation, we got 52 languages across this continent, coast to coast to coast, and our people successful for tens of thousands of years, and with every potential for genius as any other human being on this planet. So I love the reflections of the dean here about standards. There is every reason why every one of our people can achieve whatever standard is thrown at us, Mr. Dean. And that we should rise to that challenge, and how do we support each other to accomplish that? But we also have every potential for foolishness as well as any other human being. And so for me, it was difficult the first couple of years of university. I'd be the first to admit, didn't do that great. But constant encouragement from the family and reflections on, you know, keeping up the standards of coming from, as Paul was talking about, the pride about where you come from. You know, you want to do well by your family. You want to do well by your nation. So I'm hearing that in the threads of the comments that are being made here about the importance of pursuing university. It's not an easy decision to take, and there's some fear that comes along with it. But the ancestors faced up to big challenges too. And so too can we in this generation. We can say, absolutely, we can take the very best of the Western world and the teachings that you can get in a university and in the schools, but we can also encourage the schools, hey, take a look at what we have, the richness of being Mi'kmaq or Nunchaknal, and all of the teachings that our people have had that made us successful for tens of thousands of years. That when the newcomers came here, they relied on the Mi'kmaq ancestors for their very survival, to figure out, what do we eat? How do we get through this cold winter? What's it like over here? And so that's what learning is too. And so we now have a chance to really go back to that original sentiment that, you know, when our collective ancestors arrived, that this can be about mutual learning. And I think that's, you know, what we see the universities like this one doing, is reaching out and developing things like an action plan and recognizing this rich history that we have. But you as learners can play an active role. It's not only about you receiving the learning, you know, even to have Jaime come and share his word Willalen, and we heard the other word that came from Ontario. And I don't know all the languages, by the way, but I just know the odd word. And so when we hear those languages, Anin. And so when we heard the reference to the different languages, it's a reminder to this country that we've got this rich cultural heritage, and it belongs to all of us. We want to see it really we want to see the resurgence. And I see more and more young people like Jaime, who I know being one who has been an advocate for language and culture and the treaties. So just great, great comments. Very powerful. Your voices are very powerful. What I'm hearing here today, the importance of education and tackling these great challenges that we all face.
Ramona, may I jump in?
Please do. Yeah.
As the chief was speaking, I was remembering discussions I've had with people from the University of Cape Breton. And I mentioned for the folks online from Oxford House, Manitoba, some of the extraordinary things happening in Manitoba. But right here in Nova Scotia, here at Mount Saint Vincent and also at the University of Cape Breton, real efforts at engaging in a way that recognizes Indigenous knowledge profoundly, because we are, as a humanity, in a hunt for the best solutions to the problems the world is facing. And Indigenous knowledge, going right back to the time of the first arrival of Europeans, we're in a hunt for the best solutions to some of the world, to some of the issues facing the world. And so at University of Cape Breton, very close to here, some tremendously exciting things. In the process of learning, that's a genuine two-way dialogue. It's not professors talking to you from the front of the room with a chalk. It's actually about sharing wisdom, sharing knowledge for the betterment of the entire community.
Thank you. Thanks very much. And we've got a couple more. Yes, good.
Thank you. I just want to mention that I worked in a school system for the last 11 years, and there's a lot of students that consider going to university. In the first part of when I worked there, we had very little graduates, but over the years it rose. But in saying that, I'm saying the value of education is rising. So more students want to go to university, but the lack of funding is, you know, is there. And I feel that because we, when the funding was always available to our community members, but now that there's more and more people wishing to get a higher level education, the funding is not available. And I hope, my son is 12 years old, and I'm going to encourage him to go to university and college, and I hope that, you know, the funding is still available, but I'll do what I can to make sure he gets through it. But again, I hope that with the value of education, there are more and more students wanting to go to university.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. And that's I think, a really important reminder, that as we expand our encouragement for more and more students to come, then the funding on in the First Nations communities doesn't necessarily increase. It's spread more thinly, so we've got to figure out a way to deal with that. Yeah. And Ashley? Yeah.
There's one comment I want to make, like, especially when considering going to university. I think for me, I'm a recent graduate at Dalhousie. I just finished my undergraduate in political science, and now I'm considering law school. I recently just wrote my LSAT, and one of the things that I'm considering, like National Chief said, was, like, I think exploring Canada and the rich cultures, and also for myself, I'm going to apply out in, like, in BC and Western Canada to kind of explore more cultures out there after being in Mi'kmaq territory. And not only that, I think when considering university, I like to challenge a lot of universities that don't offer an Aboriginal language, because we do have such varieties of dialect. But for me, what my biggest challenge in doing my undergrad was having access to a language. For a lot of universities here, for your undergrad, it's a requirement to reach a language degree to get your BA. And it was hard, because I'm living in Halifax, to access a university here that offers Mi'kmaq language. Mm-hmm. And I think that was probably one of the biggest challenges. So that's probably my challenge, to help us as university students or high school students when considering going to university, to have that opportunity to choose to take our language at the university institutions.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Good.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Kara Paul. I'm from Eskasoni First Nations. Can you hear me? I run the Aboriginal Health Science Initiative program at Dalhousie, and one of the things I've really been pushing our university, and I want to actually challenge all universities across Canada, to really create solid bursary programs, entrance scholarships. But one of the important things they really have to do is graduate programs, professional programs, because our students, if they do have funding, as you all know, we only have enough funding months to do an undergrad degree. And then our students are locked out of professional programming and funding, as Tanya has just, Trina just discussed, sorry, Trina, that, you know, there's they can get an undergrad degree, but we need our people to become professionals, healthcare professionals, lawyers, doctors, pharmacists. And in order to do that, a lot of our students need to access professional programs. And we need to, as universities, to provide that bursary funding for them if we're serious about trying to educate the Aboriginal population. So it's just something I want to share, because we're doing that at Dalhousie at the moment. We put an endowment fund together for Aboriginal people in the Maritimes for the medical school, because medical school is very expensive, and a lot of our communities can't afford that. So I just wanted to share that.
Thank you very much. These are both great comments. Derek?
There was also a question asked on how you consider going. This is from Margie from Sault Ste. Marie. It says, I'm not sure how to apply to the right school. How do I find out about programs offered across Canada?
Excellent question. And maybe, I know you're not a national recruiting expert, Paul, but I wondered if, for example, the AUCC website does have university information, but there are other sources as well. Maybe you would just kick off with that?
Sure. I'll just very directly say that if you go to www.aucc.ca, you'll find a whole wealth of information. That's our website at the association. It will include a list of all universities in Canada and all the programs that they offer. The other element I might suggest you look at is a document called Answering the Call, which is a collection of the programs and services offered in particular for Aboriginal students across the country that was released about 18 months ago. And that will also point to which institutions are providing more bursaries and scholarships, which institutions have got First Nations centers and incorporate Indigenous knowledge into their curricula.
Did you say that's linked from the AUCC website?
From the AUCC.ca website.
Great,
that's right.
Answering so the call.
It will also have on that website information about scholarships that exist for all Canadian students. So three things to look for on that website. If I may, I'll just respond also to the comments that have been made about the reality of funding. And I think it's really important that those statements be made at every gathering like this, because it is true that there is a gap in Canada in terms of the support for Aboriginal students. And we all have a role in closing that gap. And let me say as well that as part of our efforts as the association, we're working to encourage increased scholarship opportunities for graduate professional studies.
Wonderful, thank you. Before we move on to question number three, did that raise any other thoughts anybody wants to bring forward?
Maybe I can just add.
Yes, please, Chief Atleo.
Well, I was wondering, first of all, maybe if Tarina had something to add to that question, because that is a question that people have, right? And there are those of you who are working directly in between supporting learners as they bridge their way into post-secondary. So I also wanted to bring that question back to some of the professionals that we have here. The other comment that I wanted to make was that there are hundreds as well of Indigenous post-secondary training institutes across the country, around the world and in the United States. And there is a national association with the support of the university and Paul's organization and local professionals that are working directly with students. They can help you find, because I used to run one. I had one back home on the West Coast with my family for the better part of 15 plus years. And we often did do transition-type programming. You know, and I remember a story where there was a young man who walked by my window in the office. He was in his 20s. And I said to my staff, I says, I know that guy. He looks familiar. And they said, Sean, you could have never met him before. He was adopted at birth, which was a story that our people know during the 60s, what's referred to as a 60s scoop. He grew up in Southern California, would look in the mirror and see an Indigenous face looking back at him, but he didn't really know what that meant. The day that I saw him was the first day he'd come across the border into Canada. And he said that he came from a village called Ahouset, and he was wondering where that was.
Wow.
Of course, that's my home. No wonder he looked familiar, right? Because he was a relative of mine. And so those are stories that are, that's not a strange story. That is a story that, in fact, is quite common amongst our people, right? There's a reconnection going on. There's a rebuilding of our nations that's going on, recapturing of our languages. I think the important point about the language I appreciate you raising, Ashley, is that for 150 years under the residential schools, one of the principal purposes of those schools was to take language away. My father telling the story about watching a fellow student have their tongue pricked when they're trying to speak the only language they knew. And this isn't that long ago. And so I really appreciate your encouragement that institutions of learning at every level can really support us to recapture that great heritage. Because as Paul was saying, you know, that's where the culture, that's where the knowledge gets expressed, is through our languages. But it's also an important aspect of identity. And so I just wanted to reflect back that there's also these institutions of higher learning that are run by Indigenous peoples. That is not just First Nations, but our Métis and Inuit Indigenous brothers and sisters across the country. So it's really about making sure we keep expanding the circle and the network and recognize each other's strengths here at the universities, National Association that Paul directs, and also the many Indigenous post-secondary institutes that are out there. So just wanted to add those few
comments. Very good, thank you. And the I've lost my iPad, so I can't refer back to that question exactly, but it is so important. There will be students in our high schools who, thanks very much, Nick, who, thank you. Boy, that was easy. See, I should have asked one of you guys. Who want to go to university, but you think, where do I start? Ideally, in your community, there will be education counselors who will be able to help you. So don't be shy about going if you do have that resource. Mm-hmm. But then there, as Chief Atleo was just saying, there are lots of places to find information. So don't be afraid to dig, because it's such an important opportunity and decision, and you shouldn't have to do it alone. So our next question is, and I'm going to reveal the last two questions together because I think they're going to be complementary to each other. First, the next question is going to ask, what steps will you take to reach your education goals? So ask you to think for a few minutes about what you're prepared to do yourself to get ready. But then the last question is going to give you a chance to say, okay, what do universities need to do to help you meet your goals? So first, your own self-responsibility, what you'll do, and then what you want us to do to help you meet your goals. So first, what steps will you take to reach your educational goals? And Ashley, do you want to read that one? Well, no, we don't. I thought we had you. Did you need to leave? You can. I didn't want to single you out. Sorry, I just did it. Ashley, get us warmed up, if you would, please, with this.
All right, so back online. What steps would you take to reach your educational goals? We have Randall Fiddler coming in from University of Saskatchewan in Saskatoon, and he says, Donce, the most important fundamental steps to reach your educational goals are to commit yourself to your studies and get involved on campus as well. I'm in my second year of Native Studies and currently the VP Aboriginal Relations of Indigenous Students Council on campus of the University of Saskatchewan. The Indigenous Students Council is a group of university or a student group at the University of Saskatchewan. Our purpose is to unify and engage Aboriginal students on campus through cultural, academic, and leisure activities. We are a council of 8 students and we work together to plan and implement programs that fulfill our purpose. Currently, there are over 1,700 Aboriginal students at the University of Saskatchewan, and each student desires to obtain a postsecondary degree or higher. Along the way, there will be obstacles and frightened moments of doubt, but the reach for higher education is a journey that students are willing to fight for. This journey begins before the student sets foot on campus. It begins during high school when the student begins to think of their career goals. Some students wish to become doctors and lawyers, while other students are still contemplating what post-secondary education can do for them. It is at these moments that our council would like to focus on. For the past year, we have worked on creating a role model program designed to connect university Aboriginal students with high school Aboriginal students. The goal for this program is to raise awareness about post-secondary opportunities available to young students. Since my first year, I've been diligently involved on campus, bringing issues to the table and having solutions. Having a comfortable transition was something I eased into, but I see a lot of my peeps on campus having issues transitioning, and I felt we on the Indigenous Student Councils had to do something.
Mm. Wow, thank you. And thanks, Randall, if you're out there watching us on the web, following along. That was a long and thoughtful answer. And all the way from the University of Saskatchewan, from someone who's in his second year of studies, and very much involved on campus with the Indigenous Students Council. And a couple of things that that Randall mentioned that I'm curious, he's talking about a mentoring relationship where the university students actually reach out and make contact with students in high school to help encourage them to see university as something in their future. I'm not going to make anybody come to the front. Just wanted to ask for a show of hands if any of you have had the chance to be paired up, if you like, with a university student, an Aboriginal student, or a student who's not First Nations, to sort of talk about what university is like. If you had a chance, anybody, just hands up if you had a chance to do that. That's great. Some people maybe have had the chance but just are scared to put their hand up because I want to make them come up to the front. No. Did you want to talk about that further? Just
sure.
Yeah, great. Thanks.
Hello. My name's Thomas Julian. I'm from a little reserve in Buckinghead First Nation. It's kind of like an honor. It gives you that feeling that it's like you can do it, like, yeah. You know, because I, you know, like my brother is a graduate from Ravensburg Law Enforcement. Mm. It was stressful, he said, but it pays off. Like, you know, if you put your mind to it, it's gonna happen, right? And actually, I want to tie in to Number three, what steps I'll take. It's kind of like a self-responsibility kind of deal. I've been working with my mom pretty much every day. I sit down, I talk to her. She tells me about the issues on my reserve. When I was 12 years old, I went to my first meeting with her about the new highway coming in. And that was a real big honor. And, like, you know, at that age, learning about, you know, economic development was probably, it was actually cool, you know, like, mm-hmm. this is going to happen. And then I'm learning about it. Like, I feel like one of the greatest kids right now.
Mm. That's great.
You know, cool. Here I am telling my friends. But, and then I'm going to tie back in with the number one question. What does it mean to me? And I believe it's, you got to get away. And like, as a young Aboriginal, I'm a singer. I was a former dancer. I go to powwows. I see the other issues in certain communities. And I see, you know, I get to go to Toronto and see the issues in this community, and or even see, you know, the positive sides in this community. You know, and I bring it back, and I tell it to my counselors, or I tell it to somebody. I usually tell it to my mom, and my mom brings it up. But really, getting away was probably the best thing, you know. And I'm kind of proud of that. Mm. Just leaving and like seeing issues, and you know, like actually, Kamloopa's power grants. We kind of stole their idea with how it's shaped and kind of formed. My mom's an economic development officer, actually, and she gets to travel all over North America and see different reserves, and she got to go to Arizona and, you know, see the big casinos and whatnot. Like, you know, it's future plans, and, you know, and then I get, you know, I'm kind of joking right now.
But getting ready to make a contribution yourself, and it sounds like your mom has really lighted up a path for you as well. That's terrific. Thank you very much.
Way to go.
Thank you. Yeah. And we've had another web comment come on. Is your turn, Derek? Yeah.
All right. This is on behalf of Xinghua, I don't know how you say it, but Anishinaabe Students Association. Mm. And they're at Algoma U, Sault Ste. Marie. And they have a question for Chief Atleo. And he says, we understand the need to reach your goals. What is the status of the 2% spending cap? There are budgets constraints for students, especially going to university in the cities. Students should not be living below the poverty line. With housing issues, traveling expenses, etc., for the high school students, the challenges that we'll face will be worth it. Utilize all your resources, participate in the community as much as you can, be sure to have a loud voice to be heard, and just lower to something else. But yeah, the question was, what is the status of the 2% spending cap?
Thank you. Thanks, Derek. Can you address that?
Yeah, absolutely. That is, it still remains in place, and it's probably one of the biggest and most major concerns that we have when it comes to our education. And I think that's, you know, clearly one of the key threads here is the challenges with current levels of funding for education, also the potential threats to education. And it is the reason why we wanted to hear as well from you directly, to not only hear about how it is that you're accomplishing, but what are the things that you see as being some of the challenges. And funding and threats to funding remain, you know, a shared concern. There is an important report that just came out on education from the Senate Standing Committee on Aboriginal Affairs that was just released last week. And we're hearing new language coming from government about working with First Nations to not only have First Nations control of First Nations education. You should all know that that's been a push that's been at the forefront for First Nations since the early 70s, when I was just a kid. I was born in 67. And the reason why I and others got to go to post-secondary and be supported was because our leaders have been pushing for this. But there are emerging threats. And one of them was the fact that funding, not just for education, but for other things like health, were capped back in 1996. So what that means is that there's been no growth. So we're the fastest growing segment of the Canadian population. Over half of our population is under the age of 25. And so in the last election, the federal government, for example, they protected transfers for education and for health. They protected transfers from the federal government to provinces and territories at over 6% growth. So that means that those resources are going up to meet the needs. But for First Nations, it's been capped at 2% since 1996. And that's the reason why this is now our fourth national conversation on online with learners and with not just learners in the post-secondary. But I'm so glad that we've got those of you that are in high school and thinking about making this transition, because this is about your immediate future as well, making sure that the country knows that if they invest in you and we can close the education and the labor market gap, this could mean $400 billion in additional contribution to the Canadian economy. That's our people. And savings in government expenditures of $115 billion. So if we think that the Prime Minister stood in the House of Commons and in 2008 apologized for 150 years of failed education policy, does it not make sense now that education be the tool that is invested in deeply for our people? So this is where I'm really thankful for the push that those who have come before us have put on education. Back in 1961, there was a report called the Hawthorne Report that didn't talk about education success. It talked about education failure to the rate of 95%. But the very first education comments were made in the 1600s, because there were efforts made by those coming overseas to educate our people. So we've been on this road to ensure that we've got fair, equitable education for a long, long time. And so thankfully, in this last Senate report, this report is not only saying that First Nations need to be involved in designing their own education, we also have the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, which was endorsed by Canada just over a year ago. It as well says that First Nations must be involved in designing education system going forward. But importantly, we're hearing new recognition that our people need to be funded on par with any learner in this country. And so that is a stated objective that we all have. And I want to help reflect back how powerful and how important your voice is here, particularly as young people, as learners, and those that are taking up leadership roles within the universities. And stepping forward, Thomas, as you've done, standing there with your mother from the age of 12, learning about that you can have a say in the future of your nation and your community, that it doesn't have to wait until you get into a role like national chief or president of a university or on chief and council, that your role to help lead the people forward it starts right now. And it begins with, placing importance on the future of our community through education. And you heard what he had to say. It's about self-responsibility, so that we can do this together. So we want to encourage Canadians, we want to encourage the federal government that they invest in all of our learners. That is at a level that's on par, equal, at very minimum, with the rest of the country. And so that 2% cap has been in place a long time, and the leadership have pressed back against it, and we will continue to advocate that it be eliminated, that it be lifted, and that we get to having the proper systems in place, and that we have proper resourcing for all of our learners.
If I can jump in on that one again, I want to say that the Association of Universities and Colleges have also been talking to the government about the constraints of the cap. I mean, there are Aboriginal students that do succeed, that graduate from high school, and then they hit a wall when it comes time to get to university, and it's because of that cap. And so we've also been adding our voice to yours and others to say we need to make sure that there's sufficient funding to make sure that higher education is a viable option. I'm going to be very concrete, maybe I'm stepping out of bounds here, but Senate reports used to sit on a file that students could never see, never read, never have access to. That Senate report is available on the website. You can go home this afternoon, and if you've got a connection at home or a connection in the library or some internet connection, you can download that report and read it yourself. And you can write a letter that says, I have read this report and I am looking for action. Because it's not just about people far away, it's about people right here in this community and communities right across the country that are going to give their voice to these issues. And the fact that you have come here today shows that you're keenly interested in education, shows that you want a bright future for yourselves and for your families. And what better time than to start right now by pushing along with the National Chief and others to make sure that the cap is taken off.
Thank you very
much. There's the political message for today.
Those are strong ones. And we've got a couple more questions. Move things along, I'll just read a couple very quickly so we can stay on our time. But we do have Pamela from Oxford House, Manitoba, saying that talking to people who've been to university would help. We're kind of moving into what can universities do. And a number of you said that you've had a chance to talk to people who've been to university. So that's a good message for us in terms of ways that we can reach out and help support your goals. We have Autumn King from Cornwall, Ontario, who says that university means a chance, a way to get somewhere. She can become a role model in her community and give back to her home. So that, again, I think is reinforcing a theme that we've heard earlier. And we have Shane Cootley from Salmon Arm Secondary School in BC. We've got another coast to coast. And this leads straight to a question for you, Chief Atleo. He says, I would be interested in hearing Shawn's perspective on academic success for Aboriginal students. What defines it for both on and off reserve people? What defines it for urban Métis non-status? How do we work towards having post-secondary education as a goal? So we'll let Chief Atleo answer that before we move to the final question. If you want to hang on to that and have a look at it.
Sure. Very, very thankful for that question. And you hear, you know, language is so, words are so important. We're gathered here focused on Indigenous education, and, you know, it's helpful to reflect, what are we talking about? And you heard me reference earlier that the Assembly of First Nations advocates and supports directly those, you know, who are First Nations. And the Canadian Constitution recognizes three distinct Indigenous peoples within Canada: First Nations, Métis, and Inuit. And what I always appreciate is especially the youth leadership, Ashley, yourself and your youth leadership colleagues are always talking about we have to be unified. That as Indigenous peoples, there's a common story that we share. There may be differences. The languages are different. There's aspects to the history that are different. You come from a reserve here in the Atlantic. Maybe your experience is a little bit like mine back home, you know, in the reserve where I come from. But if you've grown up in the city, there's going to be a different story. You heard me reference that story of the young man who didn't even know what it meant to be a Nuchonal because he grew up in a non-First Nations family in another country. None of that was his fault. And yet this is the history that we've all inherited. It's a history where there's been a lot of externally imposed divisions, whether it was a residential school taking a child from their home, or somebody being adopted to Southern California at birth, or having an Indian Act that externally says somebody's status or non-status, even though they might have the same roots of families from Eskasoni or Ahouset. So we have to be very conscious of, and this is where institutions of learning can help. And I wanted to begin there because we are inheriting as a generation a long history of divisions and conflict between and amongst ourselves as Indigenous peoples, as well as misunderstandings between Indigenous peoples and the rest of the country. So I wanted to just reflect that, because what it means for today is that whether you're living in a reserve like those of you who are here, or whether you're in the city of Halifax or Vancouver or Toronto or Montreal, you come from that shared history, and everyone needs to be supported to achieve success. So if you're an Eskasoni citizen living in downtown Toronto or an Ahouset citizen living in downtown Vancouver, you're coming from the same history, you should be equally supported to achieve success in life and have the opportunity to achieve success wherever you choose to reside. And you heard, for example, Ashley encouraging that in the universities, even in the cities, what about language and cultural supports in the cities so that you can be supported to retain contact or to learn about your own personal history. So this is going to be a really important time that we don't allow those historic divisions to pull us apart, to be unified as First Nations, to come together as Indigenous peoples and support one another, recognize our diversity, but make sure that we work together. And so I think reflecting Shane's contribution from Salmon Arm Secondary, I'm really thankful that Shane has asked that question. In the end, Shane, and for everyone here, this is about our relationships between each other as people. Relationships that there has been, in my personal experience, there's been deep conflict. It's like we push people away. You grew up in the reserve, you come home, your Hauset language sounds a little bit funny. And all of a sudden there's a division that we didn't create. Or somebody who grew up with their grandparents, like I had the great privilege to do, but then somebody who didn't. So maybe they don't know the songs, maybe they don't know the dances. And so it's like there's these divisions that have crept in. But what we got to do is we got to support each other, no matter what our backgrounds might be. Recognize what we have in common and build on that, and build our strength based on what we have in common. If there's one thing that I'm particularly interested in seeing us challenge directly as Indigenous peoples, that's to be united. But I also want to go one step further, and I want to encourage our partners, those in the university and governments and in business and industry, to recognize that they can also play a role as well. That how we understand the Indigenous population requires us to be in communication with them. We speak to the Mi'kmaq when they're in their territory. We understand that the Métis Nation will have learners here, perhaps the Inuit peoples as well. And that we engage with them to understand what's the best way that we will support their work. And that is the shift that I feel is starting to come about. And that is that no one individual should be charged with making some top-down decisions for us. But that it's got to be led by the people, by the grassroots, wherever they reside, whether they're in the cities or whether in the isolated reserves in northern Manitoba or northern Ontario. We've been hearing about so much in places like Attawapiskat. Those are realities that we have in our communities right now. So it's the people's voice. It's coming this from the grassroots. And how do those of us in these roles, how do we support those voices to be brought forward? So that's going to be really important. I'm really thankful for Shane's comment here, because this is about how we treat each other. And I think it's so critical that we go back to the notions of respect and mutual recognition.
Thank you very much. And I think you've also provided, as part of your comments, a perfect transition to the last question. And because you call on us as partners to play a role in making education of Aboriginal youth a reality. So the last question is, and this is your chance to tell us what to do. Grown-ups are always, elders and elders are always telling you what to do, but here's your chance to let us know what you think we should do at the universities to help you reach your educational goals. What is it? And we've heard a few things. Ashley talked about the fact that she felt it would have been a real help to her if there had been Indigenous language offering so that she could take that as her language course. There are there's been some discussion, just to sum up a little bit, of the need for more scholarships, more financial support. So what are some other things that, and some of you haven't been to university yet, so maybe it's asking you to imagine ahead what we should be doing to make your pathway easier to come here and join us, and what we should be doing to support your success once you're here. So I don't know if we haven't got anybody online yet with that one. So I'll just rephrase it, or actually I don't have to. Ashley's gonna stand up and start responding.
I'm not sure if this is like a realistic goal, but what I see in the future, especially for smaller universities that are university institutions that live in areas and municipalities where there's not many First Nations communities. I know in Nova Scotia we have 13 First Nations communities, and there's a lot of large First Nations communities, especially in the HRM area where we have like Indianbrook and Millbrook and the Acadia First Nations and also Buckingham. And unfortunately, not like Onamagi, which in Cape Breton they have CBU, which also offers a lot of First Nations opportunities at their universities. But I would like to see some way that the universities here in HRM can kind of build a First Nations network together in terms of making that opportunity for us to access an undergraduate degree that's based on First Nations. I know that a lot of the institutions offer a minimum one or two programs or courses within their curriculums, and I think that it would be to foresee a way for us to be able to access those programs, to take those courses and kind of build a network that says Dalhousie offers so many courses on First Nations studies and our Indigenous knowledge. The Mount Saint Vincent offers these and Saint Mary's, because the three of them are located in such a close circumference that we'll be able to kind of access those. Because when you're in an institution and you're the only First Nation student in your class, that's a barrier. It's a barrier because a lot of us feel that we are alone, and it's hard for us to kind of succeed in that area because we're continuously learning a lot of what Canadian institutions had put together information for us to learn. But as an Indigenous, as a First Nations, I want to learn about our culture and what we have to offer. So that's kind of what I foresee for the future. And that's kind of the another thing that I'd like to see among the universities.
That's a great idea. And I don't see any reason why we couldn't make that happen. Thanks, that got us off to a good start. So the universities in the Halifax area, and there are three of us, join together, pool our resources so that we have some programs focused on Aboriginal culture, heritage, history, whether it's wide open in terms of how those might be focused, and be able to do it by working together in partnership. Thank you. Other thoughts about what we should do to help you reach your educational goals? Dr. Deverell.
Well, since Dr. Lumpkin said faculty could talk, I'm taking this as an opportunity to invite people in the room or people who are close to a number of events that are happening here at the Mount. I'm Rita Deverell. I'm Nancy's chair in women's studies. And we have two things that are for high school students specifically that you may be interested in. And I'll have to put my glasses on so I can read this. This is Friday, February 3rd, in this very room, from 10 to 2. We'll provide lunch. And who will be here doing a workshop for high school students? So this is, so to speak, a free course that you won't get graded on. So it will be very low stress. Shirley Bear, who is a very distinguished visual artist and activist from the Tobique First Nation and is an older woman, along with Ursula Johnson, who is a younger woman, a visual artist, a Mi'kmaq basket maker, who will be our art gallery's artist in residence for the winter term. So February 3rd, this very room. And if you can talk to me afterwards about this opportunity. The other one is February 10th, this very room, 10 o'clock. Joan Glode, who is actually the first Aboriginal graduate from Mount St. Vincent and is a founder of Mi'kmaq Family and Children's Services, will be here with Ruth Cuthan, who is a visual artist from Saskatchewan, who will have an exhibition in the Mount Art Gallery at that time. And here's a third one that's not specifically for high school students, but is for the public. And you all look well enough behaved to come to something for adults. This will be February 15th, Wednesday night, in this very room, 5:30. Dorothy Christian, who is an Okanagan Shuswap woman, who is presently working on her PhD at the UBC First Nations House of Learning, and is mainly a film critic. So you're invited, and I will be happy to spread more propaganda when this session is over.
Thank you very much, Dr. Deverell. So that's given you an opportunity to hear some of the things that are going on at the Mount. There are things going on at other campuses across the country, across our province, in particular across the country. Do we have someone else coming to the mic?
I was just going to let a student make a comment first.
Please, yeah.
Okay. Well, I can talk about my experience. I mean, I'm from Meskazoni First Nations, and I went to university. And one of the things I noticed going away, I went to Acadia University for my undergrad, then I went to Dalhousie. The curriculum, if there's not enough inclusive in curriculum, I find one of the things we have to work on is our retention with our students, because we get students in, but we're not able to retain them or get them out of the university to graduate. So I think it's really important at the universities that we really develop our curriculum to be more inclusive. And that goes back to what Ashley was talking about, that should be more content. And not even just specific Aboriginal courses, but actually pepper the curriculum all the way through. Like, mm-hmm. I work in health, and one of the things that we're trying to develop at the university at Dalhousie is trying to develop a health certificate, Aboriginal health certificate, when you graduate from one of the health sciences. You can do that. We're working towards that goal. We do have some elective courses now. We have Introduction to Aboriginal Peoples and Health at the moment, and we're looking to make a suite of courses in that. And I think one of the interests in our university is to take all the different courses all through the different faculties and make it interdisciplinary studies. But one of the things that we really need to develop, I don't think there is a graduate program in the Maritimes on Aboriginal studies, and maybe that's something that we should all look at developing. There's not one specifically at the moment. So I think that one of the things that we're working on right now, we're developing a bridging program into health sciences, because as myself, when I went to Acadia University, I graduated from high school and then went to university and did a Bachelor of Science degree, and it was really difficult. There was a huge steep between high school and university, and it was really, really tough. Like Chief Atleo said himself, I didn't do very well my first year in university. I really had a really tough time doing a Bachelor of Science. I mean, so we have to support our students. It's not enough for us to go and do targeted outreach, but we have to make sure that we have all our supports in place and all our retention issues gone so our students can succeed in our programs. So we're developing a bridging program at the moment, so that will help that bridging program into the health sciences, so we support our students so that they can get into health careers. That's one of the things we're trying to develop. And I'm hoping that we can have a language class eventually in Mi'kmaq, Ashley.
Ah. Thank you very much. That was very concrete and helpful.
Actually,
yes, Thomas, please.
I'm gonna relate to all this, because I go to a school off reserve, and you know, I'm in my Canadian history class. I don't learn much about my own people, kind of deal. I learn about we were the first here, I guess, and that's pretty much it. We have a Mi'kmaq studies class, but that just kind of came in, like, you know, like African studies, like it all came in afterwards, like not too long ago. But like, even growing up, I never learned much about my own culture and like in my school, you know, I didn't get to learn Mi'kmaq language class until grade 5 or 4. Like, I find that's a big concern, like how I don't, like it took me this long just to start learning about my own culture. I had to go to my own elders and learn about my culture and what actually happened in the residential schools, not just slaps on the hand. And, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I find that a big deal. And like, you know, I hope the books get changed. Instead of just one page, I want just as much as the World War I and II pages.
Thank you very much. And that if I understand you, you're saying that just to bridge to our question, that if you had more chance to study your own culture and history within high school, I'm gonna extend that a little bit, that it would give you more engagement, more sense of inclusion, more motivation then to be prepared to come on to university, where, again, to follow Ashley's comment, we would need to look. Sorry, it wasn't Ashley. We would need to look at our curricula here on campus to make sure that we've got an inclusive curriculum here on campus to follow on. Michelle, Dr. Forrest, one of our faculty in education here at the Mount.
Now that Rita's broken the ice, I'll so speak. Yes, what can universities do? I think that what we don't take into account sufficiently is that our concept of knowledge and the way we teach is so Eurocentric. And as a result of that, certain universities where they have Aboriginal studies programs, they've had to work out ways of, in a sense, finding a system to legitimate the knowledge of an elder. We don't have that. The University of Trent have the best language around that, so that if you have an elder as one of the professors at that university, there is a mechanism for that person to advance. And in order to do that, at universities, professors had to really stretch their thinking, those of us from a Eurocentric background, to understand that knowledge is construed differently. And so until we can see that knowledge could be much broader and that it's not simply a linear process of information accumulation, that until we can see this larger way of looking at knowledge that Aboriginal peoples have had long before we evolved as European and the descendants of Europeans, then we can't really bring into the curriculum the way of thinking that allows it to expand this way. So in order for me and an education faculty to be able to inspire young First Nations students to become teachers, I need to bring an elder in to tell me how to do that. And so perhaps if we don't have Aboriginal studies programs ourselves, perhaps we should seriously think about having an Aboriginal elder on a Senate or on a board of governors to actually allow us to think in ways that we have not been accustomed to thinking.
Thank you very much. It's Dr. Forrest from our education faculty. Ashley, do you want to bring a comment forward?
Yeah, we have an online comment. So what can universities do to help you reach your educational goals? And this is from Larna Bell. And Lorna says, I believe that universities have a role to play in a practical sense and as advocates on behalf of Aboriginal people across Canada. Should post-secondary institutions not lobby government for funding of Aboriginal education, they have a role to play as innovators in the field of education. Innovative non-traditional delivery methods can be employed and advocated, especially in the case of isolated reserves. Fiber optics, for instance, will allow the delivery of education to isolated communities, provided and accompanied by technical support. Fiber optics, along with Aboriginal content in the curriculum, I believe will generate the necessary interest and can be used as the foundation which I spoke of earlier. I believe that Aboriginal students have a role to play in contribution to make the higher education in a sense that their voices need to be heard. In order that these voices are heard, we need to invest in their future in order to equalize the prospects by providing opportunity to all of them.
Mm. Thank you. Very strong statement. Now, I'll just quickly read someone who's written specifically about what university should do. I think I just lost that. There are a couple of other good comments. I think we're running close to the end of time, though. And yes, here it is. Just want to quickly go through this one because it does address this last question. And the other comments, thank you very much, those out in Webland who've written in comments. I think you're reinforcing some of the same some of the same ideas and thoughts that have been discussed, which is very positive. And we will have a summary of all your comments available. What universities need to do, more recognition of Aboriginal peoples in the curriculum, and we've heard that loud and clear. And also in overall university life, an Aboriginal language course, and also not only history, but present-day activities of Native people. I don't want to feel separated from other university populations. I think there needs to be more recognition of our people. Thank you. So I think that is a good place for me to start winding down, but I'm just going to pause a moment to see if anyone else in the room with us wants to make any closing comments. And if not, I'm going to call on Chief Atleo if he would like to say a few closing words.
Well, I'm really, really inspired by what I've heard here, both online and in person, and I'm very thankful. Some of the way that we're concluding here is Dr. Forrest, I really appreciate your intervention. and the suggestion about the role of our elders, it's sort of where we began. Mm-hmm. You mentioned, you know, connecting with the elders in our communities, and that's where I received my foundation. And like any of the other, especially young guys here, when you're faced with those choices and moments in life, you know, when it's down that road over there and we know where that heads, it's probably not a very good path to go, you know, or you choose the path, you know, that I'm hearing that many of you are on the road to choosing. I want to encourage you to strongly consider that for this reason. And it connects, Paul, with what you said when you were referencing Indigenous ways of knowing. As the world is challenged by conflict, there's wars in other parts of the world, there's deep challenges with the relationship with the environment, with climate change, right? The world leaders were just meeting in Durban, mm-hmm. South Africa, talking about the state of the relationship between people and the living environment around us. And as the images of Attawapiskat got brought into the living rooms of Canadians, many for the first time, you know, through the advent of social media, you know, that people could see because of, you know, online images, what the realities are. This is about relationships, and the power of academia, the power of the scientific method of inquiry, the power of universities is that of critical analysis. It's to pull reality apart and look at all its different elements and its minute detail. It's to understand the philosophies that are the underpinnings of education systems here in Canada. It's to understand where the laws that created things like the Indian Act, where they were rooted from, where they came from. Because we've all collectively inherited this. And what's the power of Indigenous ways of knowing? Very powerful notions about keeping reality whole, about finding balance and harmony between living things, between people and the environment. That which we were successful for tens of thousands of years and much longer. And that's what was found when the newcomers came here to Mi'kmaq territory, was a people with government, with laws, with morals, with order, everyone with food in the belly, clothes on the back, and a roof overhead. And everyone with a role to play. And just like we are doing here today, that every voice, every single voice from every individual, no matter the age, must be supported, respected, and not just heard, but that we seek to understand. There's so many powerful things that it feels to me that whether you're Mi'kmaq or Nuchanal, that we have to offer each other as well as the world. And I do believe that this is our time as Indigenous peoples, where there's a great resurgence happening. And I can feel that in a room like this, and in interaction with a university that has the potential to be one of the great transformers of not only our relationships, but help to unleash the human potential of individuals and facilitate greater understanding between peoples within Canada. Coming from a family of educators, I've seen this firsthand. My dad was my first teacher, my first principal back home. And the strap was still legal back then. Well, I'm just old enough that I would get the discipline in class, and then I'd get it around the living room table. And the earlier last piece on my part is the theme around about taking responsibility, Thomas. And there was a lady who earlier said online that she had the expectation that she would succeed, that she would go to school and that she would succeed in school. And if I have a dream for our people, is that every young person will have that in their life. They'll have support from their parents, you know, from the leadership and from their grandparents. And that expectation will be is that we will accomplish this. Because my father always said, son, you can have what you say, but I can't do this algebra, it's too hard. Son, you can have what you say. Oh, there's got to be an easier way, Dad. And I was never given an out. There was no easy way to. So I did. Took me two chances at it. And my then girlfriend and now wife of 25 years, she helped me succeed in passing Algebra 11. I had to take it twice, but I did it. You know, I finally got it. And so the point here is that there is no easy way, that there's the hard way or the harder way. And the harder way is if we try to find that easy way. And so some of us learn that, you know, we learn in a difficult manner, that just get on with the hard work. And that's for accomplishing school. It's for bringing back our languages. It's for reconciling our relationship with Canadians. I feel this is the moment, and you are the generation that are going to take us to heights that we have never seen before. The dark chapter that we've come through, it's been real, and it's still with us in so many respects. But I really feel confident that you here in this room and that you online with partners like the ones that I'm sitting beside here, such as in the education faculty and the leadership that we have here, we can make this happen together. Thank you for the great honor to be here amongst you, to hear what it is you had to share on your hearts and on your minds. And thank you to, as you lovingly referred to yourselves, the University of the Mount. Thank you for having us, as well as the Assembly of First Nations, and for your great partnership, Paul. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And I would just like to close by saying that Mount Saint Vincent University, the Mount, has had a number of us here today, my colleagues and I, listening carefully to what you're saying. And I believe we've learned a lot, and I commit to our bringing that knowledge into action on behalf of strengthening education for First Nations and Aboriginal students on our campus. So it's a good beginning for us as well to build on where we've been before, and it's been our great privilege to have you with us here today, both on the webinar, and there are a few additional comments that have come in that will be reflected in the recordings. Thank you for writing, thank you for being here, and thank you, Chief Atleo, very much for your presence today.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
I can see they're going to pull you.
Yeah, very good. Very good stuff. Yeah, you as well.